Today, I want to explain about interrupt storm detection feature, which I developed. This is today's agenda. Firstly, I will talk about background why I developed interrupt storm detection feature and existing ways to debug interrupt storm. After that, I will talk about our development to debug interrupt storm. Before my presentation, I'll introduce myself. I'm Kent Kobayashi from Sony Corporation. I'm responsible for Linux kernel and device drivers for Sony products like Aibo, digital camera, Blu-ray disc recorder, and so on. Today, I'd like to talk about my development interrupt storm detection feature in Linux kernel. Now, let's start my presentation. At first, I will talk about background why I developed this feature. Before explaining my development, I'd like to talk about interrupt storm. An interrupt storm is a continuous interrupt from hardware to CPU. I think most Linux kernel engineers have seen this problem at least once. When interrupt storm occurs, an interrupt handler will be executed by CPU continuously in short time, like this figure. Interrupt storm causes the system to hang up, because the interrupt handler will use the CPU continuously, so other tasks can't use the CPU. So it is hard to debug because the console is not responding. To debug interrupt storm, we need to identify which IRQ causes interrupt storm to check device driver and hardware. But it is very hard to identify. Interrupt storm mainly occurs in two cases. Case 1 is unhandled interrupt, known as a spurious interrupt. Case 2 is high-frequency handled interrupt. Unhandled interrupt with where an interrupt handler does not handle the hardware interrupt. Interrupt handler should clear interrupt status and do necessary post-processing for each device driver when interrupt is raised. But in this case, interrupt handler does not do those actions. This case is caused by problems in the device drivers. Interrupt handlers do nothing if the raised interrupt does not belong to it. So the interrupt is not cleared and will be raised again and again. When an IRQ is shared by multiple device drivers, this case can occur. Generally, with shared IRQ between multiple device drivers, each device driver should ignore interrupts that don't belong to it. But if the interrupt handler incorrectly ignores the interrupt, it will not be handled by anyone. So an interrupt storm will occur. And the other case, if the device driver forgets to register interrupt handler, this also not handled raised interrupt. So interrupt storm will also occur. To debug case 1 interrupt storm, we can use the spurious interrupt handling kernel feature. That is implemented after 2.6.10 kernel. When an interrupt storm is detected by this feature, disable interrupt and print IRQ number, which raises 99,000 times spurious interrupt. When this feature detects 99,000 times spurious interrupt, this message is displayed. So we can clarify which IRQ number causes an interrupt storm. After that, as you know, we can work out What interrupt handler is registered on each ILQ number by proc interface? In this case, who interrupt handler is registered? So we can investigate which device driver register who interrupt handler by checking source code. Then we can work out the cause of the interrupt storm. Next, I will explain about this spurious interrupt handling feature mechanism simply. This is a simplified explanation of spurious interrupt handling. Firstly, first spurious interrupt occurs in T0. And if next spurious interrupt occurs in before T0 plus 100 millisec. Increment counter. And the next spurious interrupt occurs before T1 plus 100 millisec. Also increment counter. If this situation continues and the counter reaches 99,000, the spurious interrupt handling feature will disable ILQ and print ILQ number. If a spurious interrupt does not occur within 100 millisecond of the previous spurious interrupt, counter is cleared to zero. This was mechanism of spurious interrupt handling feature. Next, I will talk about case 2 interrupt storm. This is high frequency handled interrupt case. In this case, the interrupt is raised continuously whether interrupt handler handled interrupt. That means interrupt handler do necessary post-processing of interrupt, for example, clear interrupt, but interrupt is raised continuously. This happens due to hardware or device drivers problems. For example, hardware design mistake or design change, these usually occur at start phase of development. And if we misconfigure the interrupt trigger, interrupt storm can occur. For example, if we set level low trigger for device, when the correct setting is edge high trigger, interrupt will be raised continuously whether interrupt status is cleared. In addition, if device driver forget clear interrupt codes, of course, an interrupt storm occurs. To debug high frequency handled interrupt, we can use some ways to debug. At first, we can use non-maskable interrupt feature. NMI feature can interrupt and can dump CPU registers and backtrace even if interrupt storm is happening. But NMI has some problems. NMI is not always usable on your development board. For example, NMI is used by other purposes, so NMI can't be used for debugging. Or NMI is not connected for development board. Or NMI can dump CPU register and backtrace, but this can't detect interrupt storm. So it needs long time to recognize as interrupt storm. Another way to debug high frequency handled interrupt is to use JTAG. I think engineers listening to this presentation know about JTAG. JTAG can confirm CPU registers and memory contents, and with this, we can work out which interrupt handler is running often. But JTAG also has some problems, like some development boards don't have JTAG interfaces, and when they do, we need to prepare config files, and that can take a long time. In addition, JTAG equipment is a little bit expensive. Another way to debug high-frequency handled interrupt is using Pistoa F2Less. Pistoa is a framework to save something into persistent memory. The contents of persistent memory remain after reboot. F2Less is function tracer. F2Less can record function call history into buffer. So, Pistoa F2Less can record function call history into persistent memory. To use Pistoa F2Less, you need persistent memory on your development board. And enable kernel config of Pistoa F2Less and build kernel. After boot up, with enabled Pistoa F2Less kernel, enable Pistoa F2Less by this command before interrupt storm occurs. After interrupt storm is reproduced, reboot your board by pressing reset button or some ways to force reboot. After reboot, you can confirm function history by just before reboot from sysfs pistoa directory. Then you can debug high frequency handled interrupts. But Pistoa F2Less also has some problems. Because persistent memory is not always available for your development board. And F2Less affects performance because F2Less records each function history on memory. As I introduced some ways to debug case 2, high frequency handled interrupt, those have some problems to use for debugging interrupt storm. But case 1, unhandled interrupt is easy to debug because we can use spurious interrupt handling feature. So we think to develop interrupt storm detection feature to resolve problems of each debug ways for interrupt storm. Now I will talk about our solution, interrupt storm detection feature. This feature detects as interrupt storm if number of interrupts exceeds a threshold per 100 milliseconds like this figure. If a high frequency interrupt happens in this 100 milliseconds, this is detected as an interrupt storm. After detecting an interrupt storm, this feature will print the IRQ number to kernel log. User can set threshold value, which is detected as an interrupt storm. User can select whether to disable the IRQ or not after detecting interrupt storm. User also can select whether to invoke kernel panic or not after detecting interrupt storm. Now, I will explain how it works in detail. In this case, user sets 1000 as a threshold. First handled interrupt occurs in T0, increment counter, and record the time of the first interrupt with starting to measure. If next interrupt is occurred within 100 milliseconds, then increment counter. If the counter doesn't reach the threshold, in this case, 1000 times in 100 milliseconds, interrupt storm has not occurred, so this feature will not detect as an interrupt storm. In this case, handled interrupt occurs 20 times per 100 milliseconds, it doesn't reach threshold, so this case is not interrupt storm. After that, interrupt occurs again after T0 plus 100 milliseconds. This to T21 becomes the next start time. Then set counter to 1 and save this T21 as first interrupt time. If the counter reaches the threshold value in 100 milliseconds, an in-depth storm is detected. This is detail of mechanism our interrupt storm detection feature. Now I will talk about how to use this interrupt storm detection feature. These are the kernel configs. The first setting is whether to enable this feature or not. Default is N. It means disable this feature. If you want to use this feature, please change to Y. It means enable this feature. The next setting, if for the threshold value which this feature detects as an interrupt storm. Default value is 100,000 times per 100 msec. This config applies to all IRQs. The threshold setting must be considered carefully, because if you set to small value, there is possibility to detect as interrupt storm whether it is not interrupt storm, which cause of hang up or exception. But if you set to big value, there is possibility that hang up occurs before detect an interrupt storm. In next page, I will talk about setting threshold. User can also set threshold for each IRQ number by using the proc interface after system boot up by using this command. Threshold is different between each systems or each devices. High frequency handled interrupt, which is not cause of hang up, is not problem. So we allow user to set threshold for each IRQ number. The threshold value to detect an interrupt storm is different between each systems and devices. So we need to think about suitable value for each system or devices. One of example of setting threshold, setting enough value to not detect as an interrupt storm in kernel config. For example, 50,000. After booting up, check how many times of interrupts are raised in the last 100 milliseconds by this command. For example, if IRQ15 counters showed 2500, then set 10,000 for each problematical IRQ number. This is one of example of setting threshold. Next, I will talk about how to debug with this feature. After interrupt storm detect, this feature displays this message. Then we can know problematic IRQ number. After that, check proc interrupts to know which interrupt handler is registered at problematic IRQ number. After that, you can debug device driver and hardware because you can know interrupt handler's name. In addition, in this interrupt storm detection feature, user can decide what happens after interrupt storm detection. The user can decide to disable IRQ or not after interrupt storm is detected. This is very useful for debugging after interrupt storm is detected because console may not hang up due to stop interrupt storm before hang up. So we can confirm proc interrupts after interrupt storm is detected. After disable interrupt, there is possibility that system can't work fine. But if urgent situation, user should enable this feature. And user can decide to invoke kernel panic after interrupt storm is detected. This is useful for debugging by stopping and show call trace. But there is some notes for these features. These features will disable interrupt or stop systems, so it is big impact for system. especially the disable interrupt feature, the system appears to be working fine, but IRQ is disabled, there is possibility that some other problem will occur. So you should disable those features after you clarify the IRQ number. These are how to use the other features. We can set these features using kernel config and proc interface. Kernel config will set default for all IRQs. So if set Y, it means enable those features, it applies to all IRQs. With the proc interface, user can set each IRQ number. So if you want to enable a specific IRQ number, you set N in kernel config. After that, you set enable to proc interface. In addition, user can access some useful information for debugging. We can see this information for each IRQ. We can see the threshold value, number of interrupts per unit time currently observed, setting to disable interrupts after interrupt storm detected, setting to invoke kernel panic after interrupt storm detected, and max number of interrupts detected per unit time. This is sequence diagram when interrupt is raised from hardware before adding features at ARM64 architecture. Spurious interrupt handling feature runs here. No IRQ debug flag can be set by module parameter. That flag default is false. So if you don't set no IRQ debug flag by module parameter, spurious interrupt handling feature works. That place is after being executed device drivers interrupt handler. So that place, we can know this interrupt is handled or not. It happens in the architecture independent part. And this is sequence diagram when interrupt is raised from hardware after adding interrupt storm feature. This will be executed after spurious interrupt handling feature. Because we can know this interrupt is handled or not at this place. This is also implemented in architecture independent part. Now I will talk about example on actual product with interrupt storm detection feature. The problem is exception, which is caused by soft lockup at do soft IRQ in our development board for a product. Let me conclude first. This problem is caused by interrupt storm. To debug this actual problem, at first, debug about soft lockup. To debug soft lockup, I used config lockup detector and config boot param soft lockup panic at first. And after build kernel with those kernel configs, boot up system with built kernel. After system is booted up, enable soft lockup panic in proc syskernel by this command. After that, reproduce problems, call trace of lockup is shown. So confirm call trace. In this case, soft lockup at do soft IRQ is displayed many times. There are many possible causes from this result. For example, deadlock with spin lock, some unpreemptible task works long time. interrupts storm occurs, and so on. To break down problem, I try to use interrupt storm detection feature. Then I used interrupt storm feature. I enabled kernel configs and set threshold at 10,000 times per 100 millisec and built kernel. After that, this message is shown with enabled interrupt storm detection kernel. Then I can see the IRQ number that caused the interrupt storm, so I confirm which device driver's interrupt handler is registered on IRQ387 by proc interrupts. In this case, PCIe device driver's interrupt handler is registered in IRQ387. So we investigate a PCIe device driver, PCIe hardware, and devices connected via PCIe. As a result, we worked out that this issue is caused by FPGA firmware, which is connected through PCIe. After that, we fix FPGA firmware. This problem is not occurred. Finally, I will talk about interrupt storm detection feature limitations. This feature can't identify device drivers which use shared interrupt handlers. We can only know the IRQ number when interrupt storm is detected. So, if that IRQ is shared, we need to do additional investigation to identify the device driver. And more one limitation is this feature can't detect interrupt handler which occupies CPU for a long time. In this case, the interrupt is not high frequency, so this feature can't detect as an interrupt zone. In the future, I will submit this feature to Linux kernel mainline. Thank you for listening my presentation.